Oh, yeah.
Looking good.
So surreal.
Okay, good morning, everyone. We're sending a number of bills to the president's desk this week that are all focused on building a safe, secure, and proud America. And clearly, for America to be a diplomatic power, it must be a military power. In order to be a military power, you need to be an economic power. It's all connected. And that's why I'm so encouraged by the results that we're seeing in our economy, our work to cut taxes and reduce the regulatory environment. We're seeing the lowest unemployment levels since 2000. 75% of small business owners are saying tax reform is positively impacting their business. Americans are more optimistic. Consumer confidence is at a near 20-year high. And this all means that people are dreaming again. They're hoping for a better life. And this is all about improving people's lives and giving them an opportunity for that better life. That's why economic growth is so important. We're also sending this week a major financial services bill that will unleash Main Street, provide more relief to our community banks. And again, so much of the red tape was impacting Americans, whether they were trying to get a new mortgage for a home, purchase a car, or meet other important needs. In addition to growing the economy, it's also been a top priority for us to rebuild our military. And this week, we consider the 2019 NDAA. Our military, for too long, has been asked to do more with not the resources to do it. It's impacted readiness, it's impacted our equipment, and we're continuing to rebuild our military with the resources that they need. It includes the biggest pay raise for our troops in 9 years. And as we look to Memorial Day, as a reminder of those who have given the ultimate sacrifice, this is a way that we can continue to support and demonstrate our gratitude to those who are serving and to those who have served. And with us here this morning is the congressman from Wisconsin's 8th District, Mike Gallagher. He joined the Marine Corps the day he graduated from college, and served for 7 years in active duty. He knows what the men and women are facing every day as they're on the front lines, and we're grateful that he's here to talk from his perspective.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would just like to express my agreement with what the conference chair said. In the 21st century, in order to protect America, we cannot separate our military power from economic power. They're inextricably linked, and that's why I'm so proud of this product, because not only does it represent an increase for more ships, for training and recruiting more sailors, soldiers, airmen, and Marines, for addressing our readiness crisis, which has claimed more of our young men and women in peacetime accidents than in wartime, but it also represents a more comprehensive approach that is geared towards winning that long-term great power competition with China and Russia that both the national security strategy and the national defense strategy make clear will define the 21st century. So whether it's increasing maritime cooperation in the Indo-Pacific, whether it's prohibiting the U.S. government from using risky technologies from companies like Huawei and ZTE, or ensuring that DoD research dollars don't go towards universities and teams that have been compromised by foreign talent recruitment programs, or taking a look at comprehensive Chinese development efforts like their Belt and Road Initiative, or our shortfalls in critical languages like Mandarin, like Korean, like Russian. This bill is a comprehensive whole-of-government approach because the military can't do it on its own. No single branch of government, no single agency can do it on its own. So I encourage my colleagues to pass it. Just as in order for our diplomacy to succeed, it needs to be backed by the credible threat of military force. There was a great Wisconsinite, Paul, who once said, his name was George Kennan. He said, "You have no idea how much it contributes to the general politeness and pleasantness of diplomacy to have a nice, quiet little armed force in the background." But so too, in order to have that quiet and strong armed force, we need a strong economy. And this bill is a significant improvement and a huge step towards turning around the cuts in our defense that we've seen in the last 7 years in particular. So thank you very much.
Well said, Mike, and thank you for your service to our country, to all our men and women who sacrifice and risk their lives for our freedoms. You know, when you look at the NDAA bill that we're going to bring later this week, we're going to whip the bill today. There are going to be a lot of amendments we'll debate, but ultimately we're going to pass a bill that gives our men and women in uniform the tools that they really need. And why is that so important? Just look at the last year. In the last year, by more than a 3-to-1 margin, we lost more men and women in uniform to training deaths than to combat deaths. Think about that. By more than a 3-to-1 margin, because our men and women in uniform need and deserve the tools that they need to not only be able to properly train for the dangerous task ahead when they're deployed, but they need to be able to train in a safe environment. They need to have planes that don't fall out of the sky because they don't have the tools they need. That's how critically important it is to get this bill passed. Not the short-term continuing resolutions that don't give our military the tools they need, but long-term certainty so that we can actually acquire the parts so that our men and women have the tools to actually go and train in a safe and efficient way. So that's why it's so important that we get this done, to stand behind our men and women in uniform who give us the freedoms that we enjoy. Another bill that we're going to pass today is such an important bill, and that's the Right to Try Act, a bill that really cuts through some of the red tape and bureaucracy at the FDA and allows people that are terminally ill to have real tools that they need and real drugs and access to the things that they need to have a chance to save their life. This is an important bill that once we pass it in the House, it'll go straight to the president's desk. President Trump has been pushing for this legislation to get to his desk. Today, we're going to actually pass that bill so that it goes to President Trump's desk and ultimately gets signed into law. And I do want to say one thing on the farm bill, because there's been a lot of conversation about the farm bill and what happened and which Republicans didn't vote for the bill. If you look at it, we're going to pass this bill. But I think the most important point of last week, when you break down the votes, is that every single Democrat voted against that bill, not because they don't support the farm components, but every Democrat in Congress voted against that bill because it actually put work requirements in place for welfare. So think about this. At a time when we've got great economic growth, because we passed this tax cut bill, the highest level of consumer confidence in people that actually believe they can actually go get a job, and companies are looking for workers. And at that same time, there's a policy that's paying people not to work. And we said, shouldn't there be a work requirement for able-bodied people? If you're able to work and there's a job out there waiting for you, shouldn't you be able to go get that job rather than being on a welfare program? And that policy alone caused every single Democrat to oppose it. I think that's something that Republicans, Democrats, and independents across the country alike would agree was a radical no vote, because ultimately it's common sense to say if there's a job out there waiting for you, you should have that opportunity to go seek the American dream, not to continue to remain on a welfare program.
Well, good morning. I want to thank Congressman Gallagher. This is his first stakeout, but more importantly, I want to thank him for his service to our country, his work on the committee, and also he stays in shape. He'd want you to make sure you noted that last week he won the race. Is that correct?
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Of course, his time was a little slower than last year, but he had the NDA markup. So.
The initiation.
All that being said, I want us to pause for one moment, and I want us to reflect on exactly what's going to happen on this floor this week. If you sat back and you analyzed what bills are going to pass, two of them are going to become direct law to the president, the scope and structure of how much we're dealing with. This is actually a very big week for America, a very big week for the House of Representatives. We're going to start with passing the National Defense Authorization Act, so everybody knows what NDAA means. As been said, largest pay raise in almost a decade. Starts rebuilding. We've watched the decline of more than 20%, and the world has not gotten 20% safer. More men and women are dying in training than in combat. We have to reverse that, and this is the beginning of it, just as we had the vote before. Also, hasn't been noted, but Doug Collins' prison reform bill. This is a bipartisan bill, giving individuals the skills when they come out of prison to re-enter not only just the workforce, but society after they paid their debt. I think this is something that many in this Congress has been working on for a number of Congresses, coming to fruition and coming out off the floor. We also have the opportunity to pass Right to Try directly to the president. I think a lot of people know this bill, though, and the story of Gordon McGlynn, young kid with muscular dystrophy, struggle, perseverance. This is actually what inspired the vice president at the time of Governor Indiana to pass this bill as well in Indiana. Think for a moment how many times you struggle. Somebody you know that has some life-ending disease, and if they just had another opportunity for a trial or another to be able to have that one more, lots of times it becomes a breakthrough. Lots of times it saves a life. why wouldn't we want to give people that opportunity? And that's exactly what we're going to do this week, sending it to the president's desk. This is something that the president asked for in the State of the Union. If we all remember, this is something that he's worked very hard on. I know many times the president's been making phone calls. So this is a very big success. And then something we have campaigned on for quite some time. We have watched Capitol dry up in a lot of different places after the passage of Dodd-Frank. We've watched a bipartisan bill get passed with a lot of ideas here inside this House. We're going to move that Senate bill directly to the president's desk, getting that reform, again, helping the economy to grow further, making community banks stronger, creating more small businesses as we go. This is going to free up a great deal of capital to help a lot. So if you focus on what we're able to accomplish, sending Dodd-Frank reform, it's going to become law, right to try, passing the NDAA, and passing prison reform. All this week, while at the same time dealing with hundreds of amendments doing the NDAA. We are committed to continue to grow this economy. We continue to make America stronger. And this week is a prime example of that accomplishment.
I, too, want to invite and thank Mike for being here and thank him for his service. But you all need to go to Green Bay and go to Gallagher's Pizza if you want to see good Irish pizza. All right. So this is, as Kevin just mentioned, a very, very busy week here in the House. We are sending the president a number of important bills. It starts with the financial service reforms that we're going to pass today. This is a bill for the small banks that are the financial anchors of our communities. If you crisscross the country, you will find that community banks have been drying up. We've been losing them. And that means capital has been starved to businesses that need it to expand. This will help reverse that. It addresses some of Dodd-Frank's biggest burdens to ease the regulatory costs on these smaller banks, costs which are ultimately transferred onto consumers. It encourages capital formation to ensure businesses have access to reliable financing. And it improves credit access for small businesses and Americans by making it a lot easier for these community banks to stay in business and to lend. I want to thank Chairman Hensarling for being a consistent champion of these efforts. No one has been more committed to getting this done than our Financial Services Committee Chairman. These reforms are yet just one other way that we are unlocking economic growth so that we can make a real difference in people's lives. We are never going to stop fighting to make this economy better, to make it deeper, and to make it so that everyone has a shot at their version of the American idea. We are already seeing these policies working, by the way. Just yesterday, the Gallup poll released this. 67% of Americans believe that now is a good time to find a quality job in the United States. That is a record high. Two-thirds of our fellow citizens in this country now believe it is a good time to find a quality job in the United States. This means Americans looking for work, they're encouraged by the opportunities that they're seeing. It means students coming out of college or coming out of technical school can feel optimistic about the job market they're about to enter. And it means workers who may have been unsure about taking that leap forward in their careers now feel more confident that they can do that. This good news does not just stop there. Utility bills are coming down, wages are going up, and business investment is up and set to increase even more. That leads to higher wages, more productivity, a sounder, firmer, healthier economy. All of this means that Americans are truly seeing the benefits of our country's economic momentum. We want to keep it going, and that is why these bills are so important, and this is such a productive week. Questions?
Mr. Speaker, you guys have a big divide on immigration, not only on policy, but it seems like there's a divide happening on process. The Freedom Caucus said part of the reason why they sank the farm bill and didn't take your offer for the immigration bill is because of discussions over tying a rule on the GoBat bill to a measure that moderates are working on. They want a standalone vote on GoBat with a separate rule. Moderates say they want them tied together. How do you resolve this procedural impact?
I'm not going to go into the procedural if, ands, or buts, but to say, look, obviously last Friday was regretful. Obviously, we did not want to see members take down the farm bill. If you remember 3 years ago when I took this job, I said sometimes we're going to go to the floor without knowing whether a bill is going to pass or not. It's going to be a messy process at times. That's the way the system works. Having said all of that, what we're trying to do is find where the consensus sweet spot is. It's a very difficult issue. Immigration is an issue that has a lot of passionate positions, a lot of passionate thoughts, and our members come from various different perspectives. What we want to do is act like a majority and be able to make sure that people can have the votes that they're looking for. But more importantly, I think it's in our interest to have a process that can produce a result that has a chance at law And it really makes no sense to me to have a process that guarantees law will not be made.
Mr. Speaker, the President has tweeted numerous times over the weekend. One of the things he said was, I hereby demand an investigation into the Department of Justice and how this all originated. Do you have any concerns about the President's approach to the Department of Justice? And do you think that what the DOJ is doing now is enough?
Well, I think they had a meeting to kind of clarify all of that. I think, number one, having the IG report is very important, and giving the IG the latitude to take the investigation where it needs to go. Having the U.S. attorney from Utah attached to the IG to give them the kind of tools they need to go after any abuses is important. And what matters to us is the Article I branch of government conducting oversight of the executive branch is that we do get these document requests honored. Look, FISA abuse is a serious issue. We, the people, the Congress, have given the executive branch a lot of power in this very important law. And it's really important that we conduct the proper oversight of the executive branch to make sure that that power is not or has not or will not be abused. That's ultimately at the big picture what's going on here. And so I think it's important that we just let the truth come out on all these things.
Is it appropriate for some of your members to ask for the identity of an FBI informant to be revealed? Doesn't that put them at risk?
First of all, that was a classified request, and I do believe, look, knowing this issue, the FISA requests are legitimate oversight requests. So it is wholly appropriate for the document requests that our committees of jurisdiction have made, because it has been within the entire scope of the investigation from the get-go. Frankly, I was a little surprised we didn't get this stuff earlier. So I do think it's appropriate in the context of the legitimate Intelligence Committee investigation that this information be provided to Congress. If it isn't, then we have a huge gap in our investigation. Christine.
Given how clear you've been about your opposition to the discharge petition, what message will you take if more Republicans sign on today and they do reach that?
Yeah, I mean, obviously we have members who were backers of the discharge petition who are really upset at the other members who brought down the farm bill over this issue. So we clearly have members at opposite ends of our spectrum who are frustrated with one another. That can happen in Congress. That can happen in a big majority party. It is our preference, obviously, to have a process where people get the kind of votes they're looking for, but that maximizes the opportunity and the chance of actually making law. I can guarantee you a discharge petition will not make law. So what's the point? I think we should have a process that actually has a chance at making law and producing a bill that the President would support.
Your response, Mr. Speaker, to the suggestion that this discharge petition and what happened on Friday shows that your leadership is failing and that you need to step aside?
Look, the members drafted me into this job because of who I am and what I stand for. I think members very much agree that what we should be doing is completing our agenda and our work. Look at what we're doing just this week. Right to Try, going into law. Dodd-Frank reform, going into law. On the way to going into law, rebuilding our military and prison reform. That's four things just this week. So our members realize what we want to do is act on our agenda, improve people's lives, and having a divisive leadership election at this time would prevent us from doing that.
Last question.
Hey, I don't know. Who are you?
ABC.
Okay. And he's sorry. Wisconsin.
Oh, yeah. Geez, sorry. Okay. That gets it. I'll get the guy with the badger lanyard. I'm sorry. I didn't know who you are. And then I'll go to Rachel.
Mr. Gallagher mentions ETE. This is a company that Congress thinks is a threat. The administration is nearing a deal with China on this. And Marco Rubio has been on Twitter this morning suggesting that China's out negotiating the United States. Do you feel that way? And do you think this?
I wasn't watching Marco's Twitter feed this morning. Sorry, I can't comment on that. But I'm not a party to the administration's talks with ZTE. Clearly, there are concerns with ZTE from our intelligence community, and those have to be taken into consideration. Absolutely, Rachel.
I want to go back to the
I figured you would.
There was a report this weekend that the White House and Mr. McCarthy, you have pushed back on this, obviously, wanted you out of the speakership. We have talked to people who have obviously pushed back on that, but they've also, again, brought up concern about the farm bill, and the discharge petition, and I'm just wondering, you say confidently you will be here throughout the entire
obviously, I serve at the pleasure of the members. Those are the people who drafted me in this job in the first place. But I think we all agree the best thing for us is to complete our agenda and not wedge into the middle of the completion of our agenda divisive leadership elections. You want to go ahead?
Let me be very clear that I read that report. That report's not true. When they brought it to me, it's not true. you're building something into a farm bill that we have to pass by ourselves because it's work requirement. If I remind people, the last farm bill, when we went to move it, failed at the beginning as well. So I think you're building something in that's not out there, but I understand the job you have to do. I just think if you look at what we're doing this week, from Dodd-Frank reform becoming law, right to try becoming law, NDAA, prison reform, it's a clear example that none of that is true.
Last time we brought a farm bill, went down the first time as well. Just the way it goes with farm bills.
And it ultimately passed.
Yep. And then it ultimately passed.
Republican only vote.
Did you go to Wisconsin?